Shalom. I want to start giving all praises to Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shah, Raka, Kadah. Respect and honor to you elders and apostles and brothers that's out there teaching and preaching this word. The word is the gospel of truth. Another episode of I'm Just Trying to Live Right. Nah, not that I'm trying to live right. I'm living right. Another episode of Glad Tidings Ministry. Okay, and this is real quick about our Savior. Okay? The ignorant people call Christ. So, I wanted to touch on a magazine that I've seen. It was old a couple of years ago. And, who was that screen there? Just bear with me. I like to have it all together. But it gives a description of our Savior in Revelations. And it's 2024. And our people still don't want to accept that the Messiah looks like us. They're still stuck in the time of the Willie Lynch syndrome or Stockholm syndrome. They can't get over. They rather accept the European Jesus Christ in that image than the so-called Black Messiah. So I guess that's why we have to do the job to purge that out of them. First Corinthians 5:7, purge out the whole leaven. You got to purge that out their mind, that way of thinking, and that image of so-called Caesar Bourget. You got to clear it out. Now, probably getting tired, man. I don't want to over this damn thing 1,000 times on my pictures. There we go. And here we go. All right, so this right here, it says, in March, I don't know if you can read the heading, but it says, in March 1969, Ebony Magazine was almost put out of business. Now, why were they almost put out of business? One would ask themselves. And it says, why? They published the March 1969 issue of Ebony Magazine with the Black Jesus on the cover. So many in the Black community, remember, this is not being, you're not getting oppositions from the other nations, okay? You're getting oppositions from the people that looks like the Messiah, okay? So I want you, that's a major point. I want you to keep that in your mind. It says, so they published the March 1969 issue of Ebony Magazine with the Black Jesus on the cover, Yahweh Shah. So many in the Black community were upset to the point of threatening to cancel their subscription. So our people got offended in the so-called Black community that Ebony Magazine put this up as a Black Messiah, someone that's similar, someone that's the features of them look like themselves. So we know that means if a person feels like that, they hate themselves. They hate themselves. Right? So it's so many Black community were upset to the point that they threatened to cancel the subscription. So they didn't want to see the Savior looking like them because they hate themselves. So proof that our people have the Florida Evans syndrome. They love the oppressor mascot, the white Jesus, till this day. Ain't that something? Ain't that crazy? So, You could go back at that. This is an oldie but goodie. Now let's go to Florida Evans just to give you insight on that, okay? Where's YouTube at? Go to Florida Evans. Okay. Now I gotta clear all this sign to something. All right, clear all that. Okay, let's do. And I know you, a lot of you know about this. Florida Evans. Jesus. Let's see if this comes up. Here we go. And this is quick to the point that I like.
Do you like having a P.O. box but are tired of wasting time and money driving to the post office?
Mama, couldn't we at least let Black Jesus hang alongside?
Forget it. The only Jesus I know is him.
Let's go to this
one. Hi, Donna.
Hi, Grandpa. Get there.
This is Black Jesus.
Oh, that's nice.
He's hanging there for Black History Week. Junior painted him.
Oh, Mama. When I sent you into the kitchen, I told you to clean, not lean.
Junior, what made you paint Black Jesus?
His face came to me in a vision.
It seems to be coming to me in a vision, too.
It's Ned the Wino.
You see how they even have our own people acting up on this, mocking each other, not knowing and not caring, and just mocking that the Messiah looks like them. And they're the greatest people on the planet Earth. That's power.
Would you say that again? No wonder his eyes are red like fire. He's from drinking Muscatel. Michael, did you know this was Ned Duino?
Sure, but that's not important. It's just a symbol.
It is important. Junior, before I tear your divine skinny arms out of your divine string bean body, why did you pick up all people Ned Duino for Black Jesus?
Well, he passed out in the gutter, and he's the only one who holds still long enough to hold.
And I know this is old, man, but this shit ain't even funny no more. This is an insult.
Black History Week. He's coming down off that wall and out of this house. Take him down.
There's no fear because Santa Claus is here. Mama, this is for you. And that's for my little man. You ready? Set, pop, pop. Hey, JJ, here you go, man.
Yeah, I'm safe. Thanks, Dad. Mm-hmm. Hey, cool, new pair of sneakers.
Just what you need for your next protest, March.
Too much!
James, I want to know where you got the money.
Wait a minute, baby. I got one more magic trick for you. Now just turn around and close your eyes.
James.
Turn around and close your eyes, baby.
Oh, all right.
All right, now just keep your eyes closed.
Oh.
All right, baby. Open your eyes.
James, this is the coat I wanted.
What did you do, James? Go partners with the Chicago police?
A coat to keep me warm, but I don't want one that's hot.
Come right from revenue.
I thought you owed them.
I did, and I paid them out of what they owed me.
What?
You remember last year all that money we spent on that operation you had?
Yeah.
Well, babe, it turned out that money was what they call a medical deduction. After I finished paying them, I still walked out the door with 140 big ones. I tell you, Floyd, I can't believe it. It's like we all of a sudden got a miracle.
That's it. And that's how we really going to get our miracle. Our miracle is going to come from the Savior that looks like us. And it is about color. And it ain't about prejudice or it ain't about separation. It's about love for the ones that look just like you. And it's time for us to unite and come together as a people. Okay? Even though we know the two-thirds is going to die, but that's what who you ignorantly call Christ laid his life down for. Okay? For the elect of Israel to come together and in a new life, okay, all of us is going to come back on one accord and going to have the laws inside of our minds, and we're going to be keeping the law, statute, commandments, and we're going to follow Yahweh Shah, who you're going to call Christ, wherever you go. It's going to be in us, okay? So we're going to be ruling like we're supposed to. There's nothing wrong with having a ruler mentality, a king's mentality. You want to have your people first. That's what that is. Your people come first. The improvement and the instructions of how the people should live, how they should, they can, your community should live through the whole Holy Bible that's ordained for our people is to keep our community tight and healthy. Thus says the Lord. This is all what the Lord is sending these commandments for. Their culture is a way of life so that we can better ourselves. And when we walk away from that, we lead ourselves into destruction. Okay? All right, so let's go to Revelation 1 and 14. Go to Revelation 1 and 14. Revelation 1, okay, and the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to his foot, and a girt about with paps with the golden girdle. Okay? His head and his hair were white like wool. Okay? White like wool. Okay? So we know wool is like a thick, woolly texture. So we know that the Messiah cannot look like anything with stringy hair, okay? So we know we have to dismiss that stringy hair image and blue eyes, right? And then it says, and his eyes was a flame of fire, okay? They say he's a wine bibber, and I believe he was also exhausted because the people always came to him, and he had to be on different journeys, but he also liked wine. He was a wine bibber as well. Not a drunk, but a wine bibber. Okay, he liked wine. And you remember, he made wine for that wedding. Okay? So, it says, and his eyes was as a flame of fire. Okay? And his feet like unto burnt, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burnt in a furnace. So, if you take brass and you burn it, what would it come out like? Copper color. Okay? Like a penny, right? Okay. And his voice as the sound of many waters. His voice as the sound of many waters. So think about if you ever been to Niagara Falls or if you ever even seen Niagara Falls and you see the water coming down, you will see that you can't even hear with that person. So he had a deep voice, a powerful voice, not a little squeaky voice. He had a powerful voice, okay? And he had, and that's all we're going to do. But I'm going to go over here. I'm going to say his hair and his hair were white like wool, as white snow. And what is, okay, so let's go into that so we can get a better. Okay. The Egyptians let the hair of their head and beard grow only when they were in mourning, shaving it off other times. So particularly were they on this point that to have neglected it was a subject to reproach and ridicule. Joseph shaved himself before going into the Pharaoh. Let me see. Among the Hebrews, the natural distinction between the sexes was preserved by the woman wearing long hair, while the men preserved their hair as a rule of moderate length by frequent clipping. Baldness disqualified anyone for their priest office. You see that? Elijah is called a hairy man from his flowing locks, or more probably from the shaggy cloak of hair which he wore. His remnant was of a camel's hair. Long hair is especially noticed in the description of Absalom's person, but wearing long hair was unusual and was only practiced as an act of religious observance by Nazarenes, all right, and others in token of special mercies. In times of affliction, the hair was cut off. Tearing the hair and letting it disheveled were also tokens of grief. Cutting off the hair is a figure of entire destruction of a people. The Hebrews anointed the hair perversely with fragments and ointments, especially in the season of rejoicing. Okay? So that's that. Snow. So let's go to here. I'm going to get it better. Excuse me, so. His hair were white. Now, I know white represents wisdom. So it says
Strong's G 3022. Lucas.
From Luke, light. So light, bright, brilliant, for whiteness, dazzling white of the garments of angels and those exalted to the splendor of the heavenly state. Shining the white garments worn on festival occasions, or white garments in the sign of innocence and purity, dead white of the whitening color of ripening. Okay. So it was white, gray. All right, silver hair, wool. Let's go to wool.
Strong's G 2053, Arion.
Wool. Okay, wool. You don't have to get nowhere. Arion is wool. Mm-hmm. Fire. His eyes. Fire. Fiery. And it says fire, literally or figuratively, especially lightning. Fiery, fire, red. All right. I guess you get the gist of it. So that was going back to that. I just want to make emphasis on that. This is very important. Who wrote this? This is John the Revelator wrote this, and he got this vision while he was on the Isle of Patmos, okay? And I believe he was sentenced to the Isle of Patmos, so he had a vision telling this, okay? right? And just to make sure, let me see something. Who wrote Revelations? All right. Who wrote book of who wrote the book? Let's see. Who wrote a book of Revelation? I believe it was John. So we got two Johns. You got John the Baptist, and you got John the Revelator. Okay, the author of the book of Revelation traditionally believed to be John, one of Jesus Christ's apostles. The author refers to himself as John in the book and states in Revelation 1:9 that he received visions while on the Isle of Patmos. This has led him to him being known as John of Patmos. Okay. So I just did that because I want to give you a description of who you ignorantly call Jesus Christ. So I gave you Revelation 1 and 14. Let me give you Proverbs 29 and 18. Proverbs 29. Where there is no vision, the people perish, but he that keep the law, he is happy. The reason why I did that, I broke that scripture down, but let me go to the NLT. When people do not accept divine guidance, they run wild. But whoever obeys the Lord is joyful. So I want to use as far as saying that when we run away from these commandments, we're in a different state of mind. Yeah, we're in a Gentile state of mind. We can't see ourselves as the head, as Deuteronomy 15, the blessings bring out. We can't see ourselves as having king mentality, okay? We can't see ourselves having love for our brothers, okay? Because we don't have a book of instructions and guidance to show you how a man, an individual, man and woman should live on earth strictly under the Lord's guidance. What else do a man have? Okay? So when it says where there is no vision, where there is no guidance, where there is no divine guidance, okay, basis of stressing, men go off. Look at the world today. There's no divine guidance. So the world is upside down. Job 9:24, the earth is given into the hand of the wicked. He covered the faces of the judges thereof. If not, where and who is he? The judges, we were the judges. So we are blind. The faces of us is blind. He covered the faces of the judges. Who were the real judges of the earth? Who was given the ordinance of the Bible? It was us. We're the judges of the earth. Then you have the other scripture that the earth is out of course. So it's discombobulation down here. Because there is no guidance, divine guidance. That's why we already know that the Lord's guidance supersedes man's guidance. It's superior to that. So without the superior divine intervention, it's all hell breaking loose. Okay. So, read it again. There is more hope for a fool than for someone who speaks without thinking. Nope. Words alone. When people do not accept divine guidance, they run wild. But whoever obeys the Lord is joyful. Yeah, that's true indeed. Now let me hit you with 1 John 4:20. 1 John 4:20. If someone says, I love God, NLT, if someone says, I love the Most High, but hates his brother, a Christian, brother, or sister, that person is a liar. For if we don't love people we can see, how can we love God whom we cannot see? Devastating to your ears. Devastating to your ears. So you see a lot of people claiming to love the Most High, but they hate their brother. If that was the case, it says, if someone says, I love God, but hates a Christian brother or sister, that person is a liar. For if we don't love people we can see, you can see people every day. You interact with them, right? How can you love the Most High when you cannot see the visible power that we can't see, but we say we love him, but your own brothers you interact with every day and you hate them? So this goes back to the Willie Lynch letter. This goes back to that article that I showed you with the ebony, that our people's in a state of mind of hating each other. If you read the Willie Lynch syndrome letter, he planned that this was going to carry out this hate of our people for a generation or generation. Stockholm syndrome, they can't get away of it. So that's why they can't see themselves as a ruler's mentality, because that sickness is still on them. They're gone. And the only way to come out is to come out through what? It says, Father, what should I do to inherit the, it says, Good Shepherd, what should I do to inherit the kingdom of heaven? To get immortal. He said, keep the laws. The laws are irrelevant in a place like Earth today in this world. It's irrelevant. Okay, so it says that, right? So let me go there. It says that. It says, if a man says, I love God, and his hate his brother, he is a liar. For he that love not his brother whom he hath seen, how can he love the Most High who he have not seen? Amen. You need to chew the cud on that one. 1 John 3 and 15. 1 John 3 and 15. And we're going to end it with this one. So can you see it? Can you visualize it? Can you accept it? The Lord is on your side and he's representing you. He's representing you. He died for you and everything. Whosoever hate his brother, this is 1 John 3 and 15. Whosoever hate his brother, think about that magazine, the Ebony magazine, when I read the scripture. Visualize it in your mind and put it together. This is easy work. Whosoever hate his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer have eternal life abiding in him. Read the NLT on the other side. Anyone who hates another brother or sister is really a murderer at heart. And you know that murderers don't have eternal life within them. So, back to the Ebony magazine. The Messiah looks like you. He coming to save the elect out of Israel first. 2/3 of our people have to be sacrificed for being hard-headed, stiff-headed Negroes. Hard-headed make a soft butt. Their destiny is to die. But all Israel will be saved. That is a promise. That is the covenant. That is the blessings. But our people, black-on-black crime, killing each other. You see that, right? So they hate each other. Once again, Israel failed. So we got to keep the commandments. Stay hard. Stay humble. Stay tight. Keep your shit wired tight. All right? And like Tahar used to say, if you cold, bundle the fuck up. That means get your shit together, get prepared. You know, do what you gotta do. If you cold, bundle the fuck up. Put some extra layers on. Alright? So excuse my language for that point, but if things get rough, man, get your act together. Okay? Get into these scriptures. That's your guard. Put on your defense mechanism. That's the whole armor of the Most High. To counteract the machinations of the devil, which is deceiver. Shalom.